Today, I'm going to talk about detailed 3D understanding of objects and scenes. And this is joint work with Pablo Arbeliz, Ross Gershik, Judy Hoffman, and Jitendra Malik. So in this talk, I'll talk about detailed 3D understanding of objects. The problem setting is as follows. You have as input a color and depth image coming from a depth sensor like the Microsoft Kinect. And what you want is detailed 3D understanding, where we have associated CAD models to objects that are present in the scene. So we basically want an understanding which a robot can now walk into the room. It knows all the objects that there are. It knows how it can grasp them, what will happen if it actually takes this chair and moves it around. I mean, we want this detailed 3D understanding which goes beyond just the pixels that are there in this image. So the first part of the talk, in fact, a large part of the talk will focus on how do we go about solving this problem. And in the end, if I get time, I'll also talk about a little bit about image description and visual semantic role labeling, as Ari was mentioning. And I call this a grab bag of vision and language, and I'll try to connect them later in the talk if we get to it. Right. Okay, so going back, so we have this problem statement where we have a color and depth image that is coming from a RGB-D sensor like the Microsoft Kinect, and we want to represent objects that are present in the scene with CAD models corresponding to them, and we want to align these CAD models to the data. Why do we want to do this? The motivation is that there is increasing availability of depth sensors in the environment, and I mean, with all this data, we need to figure out how to understand this data. This is intimately tied with perception for robots. So if you have a robot and it wants to go around, then detailed understanding will be useful for it to plan different tasks and go about executing them accurately. I mean, as an instance, if you look at this latest video from Boston Dynamics, I mean, robotics world currently still uses QR codes for perception, and we want to get rid of that limitation and make it possible in the real world. And then there's obviously the scientific question of how can geometry help for different computer vision tasks. So over the last few years, we have developed a set of algorithms for solving this problem, and it has touched upon a lot of core central vision problems like reorganization, where the goal is you want to detect contours and region proposals in images. We then studied problems of associating semantics with objects that are present in the scene, so problems like object detection, and then going on to fine-grained reasoning like, okay, what are the exact pixels that belong to this particular object? What pose is this object in? And then finally using this output to generate the 3D representation of the scene. And in all of these tasks, in all of these different problems that we have studied, we have tried to study the role of how can the depth image be used most effectively in trying to solve these different tasks. So what is the role of depth in perceptual organization? How can you use depth to train better object detectors and so forth? So before I actually dive into how we go about doing all of these things, here is some output. So on left, you see the color image. Then you see the detected object and its segmentation in the image. Then you see the CAD model that has been placed, and then how it overlays onto the color image. So I mean, these are some examples. Here are some more examples, and so I'll try to dive into how we do this. So before I go into this, I'll talk about some amount of related work. So when the Kinect actually came out, like 3-4 years ago, people started doing all these standard vision problems like semantic segmentation and object detection. And there were efforts both in the vision community and in the robotics community where people were trying to do instance detection, object detection, and so forth. But in my, I mean, so all of these were very good first steps, but these were still trying to solve problems which could be solved from color image themselves in a better way. More recently, there has been effort towards going towards richer 3D understanding, more complete understanding of objects, of these images. So for example, there is a line of work on 3D detection, where you not only want to say, okay, what object, what is the 2D bounding box, but you also want to say what is the 3D bounding box for these objects that are present in this image. And there has been a line of work along this direction. But the most related to what I'm going to talk about today is this detailed 3D understanding. And one particular example of this is seeing 3D chairs, where the goal is to actually bring in CAD models and align them to the data. And that understanding goes beyond what you see. You also know how this chair will look like in a different view. You know more about the chair than what you actually see. And I think that is the kind of understanding that I think will be useful for in a robotics-like setting. There's also work from Derek Hoehm's lab on this, which is sort of contemporary to ours. But I mean, there's comparisons with all of these different works in the papers. You can follow up on that. So with this, I will start with the bulk of the talk. I'm not going to talk about everything that I showed in the first few slides, but I'm going to pick out key four nuggets that that have come out in my work. So the first is, what is the role of depth in perceptual organization? How can depth be used for better contour detection and region proposal generation? The next is, how do you encode depth images optimally for recognition? How can you represent depth images such that they can be more useful for recognition tasks like object detection and so forth? The next what I will talk about is, how do you learn CNN models on image modalities like depth images for which you do not have enough labeled data? How do you go about training CNNs which require large amounts of data when you do not have enough labeled data? And last, I will talk about how do you go from a 2.5D representation to a full 3D representation as we desire. Right, so what is so I'll go into each of these bullet points. And the first one is, what role does depth play in perceptual organization? So what is perceptual organization? It is the task of detecting contours in images. So you have these color and depth image pairs coming in, and you want to say, okay, where are the object boundaries in these images? And a related problem is, what are these bottom-up region proposals that cover the object optimally? So you want to come up with a small number of regions which represent the different objects that are present. So you want like a region which overlaps well with the chairs in the scene. You want a region which overlaps well with tables and so forth. So for studying this task, what we did was we defined local gradients on depth images. What we do is you have this given depth image, and you want to define local gradients which can detect discontinuities in the depth image. So for example, there are these depth discontinuities where there is an occlusion boundary in this image. So the way we detect that is by estimating local planar fits to the data that you're seeing, and then looking at, so you estimate the local planes, and then you look at the distance between the plane at that particular location. And that gives you basically a depth contour, which is, okay, here there is a depth discontinuity which corresponds to occlusion edges. Next, what we do is we also determine surface normal discontinuities. So for example, a surface can bend towards you or bend away from you. So for example, all these boundaries that you see which are at the interfaces of different walls and floors. So these are surface normal discontinuities. These are not discontinuities in the depth. And once you have estimated these local planes, you can actually compute the angle between them, and you can estimate these surface normal discontinuities. So it is important to distinguish between convex and concave surface normal discontinuities. So for example, all these discontinuities which arise due to objects being placed on surfaces, you get concave normal gradients. And it is and all the internal contours, for example, this one as at the boundary of the contour and the shelf, these are convex normal gradients. And it's important to distinguish between these two because one of them corresponds to object boundaries and the other doesn't. So once you compute these local gradients on these depth images, now you can basically use these with any standard off-the-shelf object contour detector. So for example, we tried this with GPB-UCM, which was state-of-the-art a few years ago, and more recently with Puerto Dollar structured edges. And once you start using these local cues, you see improvements in performance for contour detection. So I'll not go into detail as to how this metric is actually computed, but higher is better, and you go from 63 to 68.6. And if you take dollar et al. Structured edges, it's a RGB-D method, and you take RQs in conjunction with whatever he has, and then you get further boost in performance. So this is good, but then we can look at what is the qualitatively, how does the output improve? So over here, what you see is you get less distracted by albedo. So you have all these internal contours on the bed, which you do not fire on anymore. You fire only on the geometric contours, which are sort of more critical. You also get high recall, so you have these faint boundaries at the intersection of walls, for example, in this image over here, which are important for scene understanding like tasks, because you know, okay, this is the edge of a room, and I mean, you can do more things with it. And you would ideally miss these boundaries if you were just using the color image, but once you have access to a depth camera, you start getting these boundaries. So this is good. You get higher precision, more important boundaries are stronger, and you get more complete objects out, which is that if you just threshold this image, you basically have grouped all these pixels that belong to the bed into a single blob. And that's useful from a downstream processing point of view. Not only that, you can also label each of these discontinuities into different kinds. So as I mentioned, there are these depth discontinuities which correspond to occlusion edges that, okay, here's a boundary which separates this table from the floor. So these are depth discontinuities, so we can mark them out. We can also mark out these convex normal gradients and concave normal gradients. Right, yeah.
How would your algorithm cope with a natural scene like walking in a forest? It seems like you're encoding assumptions about planes and 90-degree angles.
Yeah, so I don't think we are, in our work thus far, we have not encoded anything which corresponds to these 90-degree angles. What you're doing is you're estimating a plane locally. So even in a forest, if you have like this trunk which is sticking out from the ground, locally the planar assumption is still true. And then you can still capture, okay, that there is this tree that is on the ground, kept on the ground, if you will. I mean, you will still get these discontinuities. There is a little bit of training that happens which makes it overfit to the data set that we are using. But in principle, the way we have designed these queues, the queues will still fire, even in an outdoor example setting like a forest. Yeah, I mean, you have to look at the pair of normals and what is the shortest way of getting from one normal to the other. Yeah, so you assume the normals are pointing towards the camera, always. Okay, good. So this was how we detect contours. Now what ends up happening is that these better contours actually result in better region proposals. So what are region proposals? These are basically chunks of the image which correspond to a single object. And in computer vision, over the last few years, people have basically been using region proposals for doing semantics. That, okay, you compute a set of region proposals, and then you use them for recognition. And what this process results in, if you start using our improved RGB-D contours in a standard region proposal generation scheme, what you basically get is a large reduction in the number of regions you need to compute. So traditionally, if you just use the RGB image, what you need is something like 3,000 regions per image to get like a particular coverage, let's say 70%. But now once you start using our way of incorporating depth information into computing these region proposals, you only need something like 300 regions, and you get the same amount of recall. So you get a large reduction in the number of region proposals you need to process for recognition purposes. And I mean, we have compared to other RGBD methods, and we are obviously clearly better. Here are some examples. So for this particular image, this is what a ground truth region proposal looks like. And this is one of our proposals from top 500 proposals that we have computed. So as you can see, you get all these fine details very nicely. And you get a small number of proposals which cover the objects that are present in the scene. Here's again more examples. So that was a role of depth in perceptual organization. Now next, what I will talk about is how do you encode depth images for recognition, and how do you train CNNs on depth images when you do not have enough labeled training data? So the dominant paradigm for object detection these days is basically using a CNN on pre-computed regions, as I said. And it was put forth in this work called RCNN, where the pipeline is simple. You take the image, you extract some region proposals, and then you compute CNN-based features. And these CNNs are typically trained on ImageNet, on large labeled data sets like ImageNet, which have a million images and 1,000 labels. What you do is you take the CNN and then you fine-tune it for this particular task. And there are other variants of this which have come up with like faster CNN, faster CNN SSD. But basically, the driving factor is this CNN that you train on large-scale data to learn features. And the question that we are going to ask here is, how do you do feature learning for RGBD images? So here are our three key insights. The first insight is that depth images are image-like enough to use CNNs. This is not that surprising in the current world, but 3 years ago, when we were doing this work, it was fairly counterintuitive. Oh, should I just feed in the depth image into a CNN? And it turns out you can do that. The next thing is, just feeding the depth image into a CNN is not the best thing you can do. You can do better by encoding the depth image into these geocentric channels. So we have this embedding called the geocentric embedding, which takes into account, which computes not just the depth image, but also height above ground and angle with gravity. So you compute additional channels on top of the depth image, which give each pixel a global context in the whole scene. And we see that this works better than just using the raw depth. And the third thing is, how do you train CNNs on these data sets with depth images when you do not have enough labeled data. And I'm going to talk more about these two things in the next few slides. So The first thing is this geocentric embedding. So as I said, what we do is we take the depth image and we compute these additional global channels, height of ground and angle with gravity. Why do we want to do this? So consider a chair in the room that you want to detect. So a chair is basically characterized by a horizontal surface at a particular height. So and a vertical surface at some which is in conjunction with the horizontal surface. So if you compute these Qs like height of ground and angle with gravity, now you can detect these kind of surfaces in these images more easily. And note that these are global features which take into account the whole scene into account and not just locally looking at a particular patch. You can determine these. So this is the intuition why this is useful, and I'll have experiments which show that this is actually true. And but the problem is we need to compute this height of ground and angle with gravity because a camera may not be in the right geocentric coordinate frame. So for this we have this algorithm for computing the angle with gravity. So what you do is as we observe that the original point cloud may not be in a geocentric coordinate frame. So what you do is you estimate the surface normal field, and you start with a current estimate of the gravity direction, so which is just the y-axis essentially. And you estimate all the horizontal and vertical surfaces. And you basically get something like this. Red pixels are horizontal and blue pixels are vertical. And what you get is now you can re-estimate the gravity direction based on this estimate of local horizontal and vertical surfaces. So you basically update your gravity estimate, and you keep doing this a few times till you actually converge. So you do like 5 iterations, and you converge. And this results in a very accurate estimate of the gravity direction. So the algorithm is simple. You estimate horizontal and vertical surfaces, and you re-estimate the gravity direction by saying that, OK, you want to find a direction vector which is as perpendicular to all the horizontal surfaces and as parallel to all the vertical surfaces. And it turns out to be a very simple eigenvalue problem, a 3x3 matrix. And what this results in is that you can basically find the gravity direction within 5 degrees for more than 95% of these scenes. And this, I mean, is very robust, and you can just use it for in a robotic setting. Earlier methods which also estimate Manhattan worlds and so on are more brittle because the Manhattan world assumption may not necessarily hold for all different scenes. But this gravity direction assumption is very reasonable because gravity exists and so on. This is only for indoor scenes, yes. But in principle, the same constraint holds for outdoor scenes also. You have this large horizontal surface which is easy to estimate. And I mean, all building walls are generally parallel to the other direction. Right. So I told you, how do you compute these geocentric embeddings? The next question is, does it actually help for recognition? So we tried it with 2 different models, a DPM-based model, which was a dominant way of detecting objects back in the day, and more recent RCNN-based detectors. So if you just take the RGB image, so this is experiments on the NYUD depth RGB-D dataset, and these are object detection mean average precision on the validation set. So higher is better, it's a number between 0 and 100. So if you take the DPM, if you just use the color image, you get a mean average precision of 8.4, which is a fairly low number, but this is what you get because of the clutter and so on in the data set. Now, once you start using the depth image, you get a large improvement in performance. So you go from 8.4 to 19.4. But then once you start using our proposed geocentric embedding, you get a little bit more improvement, 2% more improvement. So you go from 19.4 to 21.7. We did the same experiment with RCNN. So you take the RGB image only, you get something like 19.7. If you start using the disparity image, you see a large boost in performance from 19.7 to 29.4. But then if you start using our geocentric embedding, you get another 3% improvement, so which is good. We also did this experiment where we removed the RGB, so then the performance improvements are larger. So you get 20.1 when you just use the depth image. And once you start using the proposed geocentric embedding, you get 25.2, which is a large improvement over not using the geocentric embedding.
Yeah.
So in this particular experiment, we just copied those weights over. And in the next part of the talk, I will talk more about how do you do it the right way. So I think what Mohammed is asking is, how do you initialize these parameters for this particular experiment? So we tried random initialization and just copying from RGB. And in this particular experiment, it is copied from RGB. But the same conclusion holds for when you do it the right way, which I'm going to talk about next slide. Other people have adopted this same geocentric embedding. So for example, Long and Schellhammer and Darrell use it for semantic segmentation, and they get a boost in performance when using this. Z and 2 use it for contour detection, and they also use our proposed geocentric embedding, and they see it does better. Yeah?
Have you tried surface normals? Just as a baseline?
So surface normals have one thing, but not the other. So they don't have these discontinuities, which are important. So you want to use, if you want to use surface normals, you will want to use them with the depth image. You will not use them just for surface normals, because you lose these all these occlusion boundaries, which are very useful.
Yeah, but I mean, just to try as a baseline, you can try it with surface normals plus disparity.
Yeah, so
those are more intuitive than HHA. I mean,
so one of the things is actually shared, right? The angle with gravity is basically shared with the surface normal.
Right.
So the only other thing is height above ground. So yeah, I mean, I don't have that particular ablation in the latest setup, but yeah. That's a good thing. I should try that out.
So, what is your intuition and why this is helpful? Because you're extracting HHA just from the depth.
Right. So I think the reason why this is useful is because it's a more global operation. So if you're just looking locally at the chair image, you don't know where this is located with respect to the whole scene. So there is this whole global scene context, if you will, that gets baked into when you're computing these channels.
I see. So that's why it helps in the detection.
Yes. Right, right, right. So that's the intuition why this would be useful. More questions?
Okay. Yes. I mean, so this global context, that is kind of very surprising. I mean, because generally the way these comnets are working is bottom up, right? Most of the things are, you are only looking local, then bigger local. Then
yeah,
local.
Yeah. But if you look at this particular example where you're just seeing this image, if you go into the RCNN world where you crop out the bounding box around the object. I mean, then you have very local context, right, that you cannot really determine all these channels robustly. If you start doing feature, I mean, so yes, you can replace this by a learned paradigm where you take the full image in and compute like a transform.
So in neuroscience, I think there is definitely always idea that V1 also gets, for example, some kind of global
feedback, yes.
Yeah, but it's just never been used in, so I'm just thinking this is very interesting that
right.
This global context, this might be one way you can actually incorporate feedback from the whole scene.
Right, I think that's a very good point. So what I should try is basically also learning this function. So in this particular case, it's a hard hand-coded function, but maybe I should try to learn this function, and that's a very good idea. I should try that. Yeah.
What would happen if a chair was knocked over and lying on its side? Would you actually be less likely to recognize?
In this particular paradigm, I mean, so any machine learning algorithm will be less likely because it's trained on the biases that you have in the training data, and so is the case with our algorithm. And I think you're right over here. I mean, if you don't have things that are there in the training set, then you don't really recognize them in the test set. So, I mean, there's a fundamental limitation of all dominant paradigms for doing object detection, for example. Okay, good. So let's now see how you can train networks on image modalities for which you do not have enough training labeled training data. So, the dominant paradigm for doing recognition these days is basically you take a very large data set of collection of images and you pre-train a network on those images, like CNN. And then what you do is you take that CNN that you have trained and you fine-tune it for the particular data set and task that you have. And you use that for object detection. I mean, so for example, if the task is object detection, you take that CNN that you have trained on this large image modality and you fine-tune it for this particular task. And then the question is, how do we learn features for image modalities, example, depth images, when you do not have access to such large-scale labeled data? So for which, we have this scheme called supervision transfer, and I'll describe it now. So if you look at neurons in a CNN that has been trained on a particular, on this large data set like ImageNet, what you basically get is that, and you ask the question, okay, what does a pool 5 neuron like? So there are basically different layers in a CNN, and you take a particular layer and you take a neuron, and you say, okay, what does this neuron like? You find all patches which activate this neuron. And there's a visualization from Ross Gershick's RCNN paper. What you see is that these neurons in the higher up layers are very semantic. And what it ends up being is, what that means is that it will fire on parts of objects, for example. So here is a neuron which fires on heads of people. Here's another neuron which sort of fires on puppy faces, and so forth. So basically, the key takeaway here is that that these CNNs, the neurons in CNNs are, the mid and high level layers of a CNN are basically semantic. They fire on semantic concepts rather than very low level image statistics. And this is the observation that we actually leverage to build, to actually be able to train networks on depth images. So what you have access to is unlabeled data, but which has pairs. So you have a RGB image and a depth image. And you have, I mean, if a robot goes around the room, then it can basically capture a lot of these unlabeled but paired images. So you have a pair of depth and color images. And what we do is that you take the ImageNet CNN that was already trained, and you extract out these semantic neurons. So neurons in a higher up layer, essentially. And what you do is that now you frame a learning problem which you want to, where you want to say that, OK, I want a similar abstract semantic representation to emerge from a depth image. So you know, you want to learn a CNN on the depth image, which can give you the same abstract semantic representation in the higher layers. So we use the training signal, the semantics that have been learned by a CNN on color images to supervise a training of a CNN on a depth image.
So your loss is actually regression
loss? L2 loss on pool 5 neurons, yes. And it is very simple. It's basically just this diagram. So what you do is you collect, you have, you take these paired images, which are not labeled in any manner, and you take the representation, this abstract representation from the RGB image, and train a network on the depth images, which mimic the same representation. And what does this results in is basically a way to pre-train networks on depth images. It will all go to zero, right? Because zero, I mean, because there is regularization. There is regularization on the weights, and then if you just unfreeze both of these networks, then the optimal solution is zero. The loss would be zero, and
you can impose something else on the loss.
Yeah. You can have another loss, but yeah. So I think where you are getting at is that you can get a shared semantic space which benefits from both RGB and depth. Yeah. Sure. Yeah, I mean,
we have never been successful, but maybe this is the right
way. Right. Yeah. I mean, so we have some experiments on that in a CVPR paper, but yeah, I mean, I'm not going to talk about them here. But that's a good point. Yeah. So now the paradigm is you take a network that you have trained on RGB images, you take unlabeled but pairs of images, and you do the supervision transfer. You get a model, and you plug into your favorite task and data set, and you can now fine tune it. So this is how you can train networks on these modalities which do not have enough labeled training data. So to make you believe what this actually, that this does what I think it does. So if you take a neuron which fires on parts of beds on the color image, and you look at the same neuron on the depth image, on the network that you have trained, and you look at what patches does that fire on, and you see it fires on the same kind of things. So you have a patch which fires on the bed images, on parts of beds. You have the same neuron, you take the same neuron from the depth image, and it also fires on parts of beds. You can look at parts of chairs, sinks, tables, and I mean, the observation holds. So this is basically, it does what we think it is doing. The next is basically a set of experiments where we have teased out different aspects of this model, and I'm going to walk you through them. So, right. So the first question is, does it actually work? So if you just do random initialization, so the task, again, the task that we are studying here is object detection on NYU. This is mean average precision on the validation set. And if you just do random initialization, there's no pre-training of any kind, what you get is mean average precision of 22.7. If you start by copying weights from RGB, which as Mohammed pointed out was done in the previous experiments, you get a little bit of boost in performance. So, I mean, copying from RGB turned out to be better than random initialization, and that's what it is. But now, when you start doing supervision transfer, which is our proposed scheme, and you do it from AlexNet architecture to AlexNet architecture, so in computer vision, you have these different CNNs that you can use for different, which have different qualities. And if you do that, then if you do fix AlexNet here and fix AlexNet architecture here, what you get is a large boost in performance. You get 25, from 25.1 to you go to 30.5. So this clearly does learn something which is useful. Now, you can ask the question that, okay, what happens if you improve the quality of semantics on the color side? So as you take different models, what you get is better and better semantics. Like, for example, there's this VGG network, which is better than the AlexNet network. And then there is this residual network, which is even better. So now the question is, does it actually improve performance if you start, if you have a better network on the color side? And turns out the answer is yes. If you start using VGG, you get 33.6, which is improvement over the previous model. Right, so the CNN, it can learn from arbitrary other RGB CNNs, which might be better. The next question is, how good are the features by themselves? So lately in computer vision, there has been debate on unsupervised learning and so forth. And there's a distinction between, there are two kinds of features. One are features which are good by themselves. And then the other property that features have is that, are the features good for fine-tuning for the particular task? Is it just, can it serve as a good initialization for learning good features? And there's a distinction between the two. And so we did this experiment over here as well. So if you copy from RGB, but just fix the features that you have learned and only learn the classifier layers on top, obviously the performance is much worse. But then with our particular way of training these models, performance is more or less the same, which means that these are actually good features by themselves. And it's not just that it's a good initialization for further fine-tuning. So this is good. The other question that one might ask is, is it, given the way we are training it, is it possible that the representation is now just completely mimicking the RGB and you don't learn anything complementary to RGB? Because that is what we had earlier hoped for. And turns out they are still complementary to RGB. So this is because you have this other small set of held out data for which you can fine tune the network. So what happens is that, okay, once you start adding RGB information into this model, you get further boost in performance. So from 30.5 to 35.6, and for the VGG one, 33.6 to 37.0. So, I mean, even given the way we have trained these networks, there is still some complementarity to RGB. Right, so those were all results that were for the task of object detection. We have tried the same network for a lot of different tasks. So for example, you can take the semantic segmentation task, and you can replace, you can do the same experiment over there with this trick, without this trick, and you see an improvement in performance. So it goes up from 41.4 to 44.7. You can also do more fine-grained tasks. So lately, it has been shown that features from intermediate layers in a convnet are also meaningful. And we do the same experiment in our setup that, okay, is the CNN that we have learned, are the intermediate layers in that CNN useful? And turns out the answer is yes. You can you get 3% improvement when you take information from intermediate layers in a CNN that was trained on ImageNet. You get the same 3% improvement when you take the CNN that was trained on depth images. So, I mean, the takeaway here is that the feature hierarchy that you're learning is also meaningful. It's not just that the last layer is meaningful. The intermediate layers in the CNN are also meaningful. Here's another experiment which one would like to see is, how does performance vary as you vary the transfer point? So note that we were fixing this to be some high or mid-level layer, right? So in this, all the experiments that I presented so far, it was pool 5 in AlexNet. The question is, how does that performance vary if you vary that point of supervision transfer? So the intuition is here is that if you start with very early layers, they are very modality specific. So because the color image has texture and so forth. So you would not expect pool 1 and pool 2 transfer at these earlier layers to work as well. And that actually happens. If you do transfer at these very early layers, then you don't get as high a performance. Because the RGB image presumably has filters which are sensitive to texture, et cetera, which can't be reproduced in the depth image. But as you go higher up, performance starts to improve till actually at like further higher layers where the representation becomes very, very not aligned in the sense that FC6 and FC7 features are very lose the spatial correspondence. So performance drops for somewhat over there. And there were this mid-level regime is where you would want to do this transfer at. These are how the different filters look like. Not sure too much can be taken from. So if you look, the filters are actually of a much different variety. You don't get any texture, which you get in the color domain. And we have also done experiments with transferring from color images to optical flow images, and the same story holds there. Right, these are the final numbers for object detection on this particular data set. So if you start with VGG on the color side, what you get is 38.8. Whatever I presented so far boosts this performance from 38.8 to 49.1. This is obviously using the depth image, but then, yes, using the depth image in this particular manner leads to performance improvements. What this additionally allows you is basically a depth and color representation which is aligned to each other. And you can do something like this. Once these representations are aligned, what you can also do is you can do zero-shot transfer of object detectors. So for example, if you have a detector that you have trained on COCO, so there's a feature extraction part and a classification part, right? Classifier part. What you can do is you can take out the feature extractor, do supervision transfer with them using a set of unlabeled pairs of images, and then you plug the CNN that you learned back into the detector. And you keep the classifier the same. So now what this gives you is basically a zero-shot detector for image modalities for which you did not have any training data for. So you had just a collection of unlabeled paired images. You do this transfer, and you get a detector for that particular modality, free of cost. And so we did this experiment that the color detector was trained on COCO, and we transferred it to NYU. So if you just use the depth image, what you get is the mean average precision of 30.4 on the shared categories. And I mean, this is far from the oracle, but this is something that you can start with. And this is particularly useful for robotics, where you might have lots of labeled data for color images, but you want to use it on a depth camera, and you can start using it in this manner. Also for privacy preserving applications in healthcare and so on. Right. So I told you about how do you encode depth images for recognition, and how do you train CNNs for modalities for which you do not have enough training data. The last part in this particular subtopic is going to be about how do you go from 2.5D representation to full 3D representation. So our output so far looks like the following, that you have this color image and the depth image, and what you get is a detection bounding box. Now, going from this, basically we want to fit models to the data and place them in the scene. And what we are doing for that right now is basically iterative closest point. So you have this depth image, and you want to fit a model to it. The challenge in doing this is that there is clutter in real-world scenes. So things are not, I mean, there's just too much background and so forth which will interact, which will hinder your model fitting procedure. You have inaccurate CAD models, which may not exactly explain the data. And third is that you do not, this kind of procedure can get stuck in local optima very easily. So what we have done is basically remedy all these limitations to get around all of these problems. So the first thing that we do is instance segmentation. So what is the problem of instance segmentation? You basically not only want to detect, but you also want to say what pixels belong to this particular object. So you want to say, okay, here is a table, and these are the pixels that belong to the table. Here is a chair, and these are the pixels that belong to the chair. And there is this other chair which is different from this chair that you first pointed out. So this is the problem of instance segmentation. And what we have done is basically, this basically gives you a pixel support for the different objects. So now you know, okay, this helps you deal with the background clutter. Now you don't need to deal with all the background that is there. You can focus your attention on the set of foreground pixels and try to estimate a model to those foreground pixels. So this is the first thing. The next thing is basically pose estimation. So as I said, ICP is very sensitive to initialization. So what we found was that if you initialize it properly with this top-down pose estimate, okay, this is the direction in which the chair is facing, it is less susceptible to get stuck in local optima. So this is what we do. We basically take these images and we produce like a prediction of where the chair is facing, and you use that essentially. And finally, with these two things put together, you take the pose estimate, you take the instance segmentation, and you take the depth image, and then you start fitting models to this data. And you can, I mean, what we found was this was robust enough to be used in practice. Right, so a little bit more about instance segmentation. The way we do this is by framing it as a pixel prediction problem. So you have detected this chair, and now you want to say what pixels belong to this chair and which don't, and you treat this as a standard classification problem. You have a CNN which basically predicts, okay, is this pixel on the chair or not on the chair? And of course, we use our geocentric embedding, we use cross-modal distillation, and we use hypercolumns, and which is, again, the same idea that you want to use features from intermediate layers in the network. So this is what we do for instance segmentation. The next is coarse pose estimation. And for this, we basically train a CNN on synthetic data, where we render synthetic models in different orientations, compute the surface normals, and just train a CNN on these surface normal images. And what we found was doing this transferred reasonably well to real data. That's what we are using for this particular work. And here are the examples, as I showed you, the image and the model that has been estimated, that has been put in the scene. Note that this is, we have not assumed any annotation this is just, you give me an image, I detect the object, I segment the object, determine pose, and then place the model in the scene. Here are some more examples. I mean, it does reasonably well on lots of these images. Some more examples. So what we have also done is basically we have used the same model Now, a trivial side product is basically you can do 3D detection. You can just take the model and you can put a 3D, put a bounding box around it, and you can solve this problem on 3D detection. This is going back to what I was saying before, that once you have this detailed understanding of the scene, then you can do all of these different tasks more easily. So you can, in this particular work, we are saying, okay, let's see if you can do 3D detection, which people have studied. So what we found was that various versions of our system, we could very easily outperform other prior methods which were using intensive 3D annotation on the data set to actually train something for 3D detection. We are worse than the latest version, which is going to appear at CPR 16, but that will get fixed in some time. Right. Okay, so this is what I wanted to talk about in RGBD scene understanding, where I went over these four things. One, the role of perception, role of depth in perceptual organization. How do you use depth images for recognition? How can you train CNNs on image modalities for which you do not have enough training data? And how do you go from a 2.5D representation to a full 3D representation? This is basically parts of the algorithm that we have finally for producing the complete 3D, detailed 3D understanding output. And most of the source code is online, and I encourage you to try it out. So I can take more questions on that part, and then I can, depending on how much time we have, I'll go into this vision and language sort of things that I have done. But I'll stop here for questions, if there are any. OK, cool. Sorry? I have less than 5 minutes remaining?
Yeah.
Oh, OK, I see. OK, cool. So I can go in more detail. So while I was, I also interned at Microsoft Research, where a couple of years ago, we thought, OK, if we could caption images, that would be really cool. And I know a lot of people in this room have actually worked on this problem. And I can talk a little bit more about what we did over there and how that led to this visual semantic role labeling problem that we have recently started studying. So. Right, so the problem statement over here is that you have been given an image and you want to generate a caption which describes this image. And I mean, I think the way we started with this was that CNNs were doing great things 2 years ago, and we thought, okay, it would be cool if we can actually caption these images. So the way we went about doing this problem was we detected visual concepts in images. So what are visual concepts? These are things like nouns, adjectives, verbs that might be happening in this image. And what we, for example, so you take this image and you try to predict, okay, what are the different objects in it, what are the different attributes, and how are they interacting with each other. Once you get these visual concepts that you have detected, now you basically have a language model which strings together these different concepts that you have expressed into sentences. And you generate a set of different, a large number of different sentences. And once you have these sentences, what you do is you take a look at the sentence and the full image, and you re-rank these sentences such that they maximally are similar to the image that you are seeing. So this part does local understanding, and then the second part basically does global understanding, that, okay, you want to say things that are actually happening in the image rather than just single things. So right, so I'll talk about each of these steps in a little more detail. So for visual concept detection, what we ended up doing was multiple instance learning. So instead of relying on object detectors and attribute classifiers that you need to train from labeled data, what we did was that, okay, we have these images which have these captions, and we assume that the set of words that are present in the caption are basically tags that are associated with this image. And you want to do is try to train a classifier for predicting what words occur in this particular image. And the way we have done this is by doing multiple instance learning. So you don't want to just reason at the full image level. You also want to look at sub-regions of the image. So you want to also try to localize them at the same time. And a standard formulation for doing this is multiple instance learning. And you can very easily latch it onto a network that you already have. You have like a max pooling layer at the end, which does global max pooling. And it leads to making the network reason about, OK, where the object is in the image. So for example, so this is just the max pooling, and you are saying that, okay, if you're training something for the camera, this image has a camera and all the other images do not have a camera, and you take the max response and you say that, okay, if there is a camera, then the max should be high. If there's no camera, then the max over the whole space of the image should be small. And you just train it with this constraint, and it leads to improvement in performance. So instead of using the full image, if you start using this multiple instance learning based formulation, you get boost in performance on all metrics, basically. So what this results in is you get like our concept detector that you can basically run on images. So we did this with the COCO data, and you can get like lots of these different attribute classifiers and nouns and verb classifier. Basically, which is good if someone wants to use, okay, now I want a detector for red, then you can just take the model and just run it. And
so evaluation is on detection?
No, so over here, evaluation is on classification. There's no detection evaluation.
So the multiple instance learning will work better. This is, I mean, like end-to-end network should work better.
This is an end-to-end network, right?
No, but I mean, there was no reason why like localization should help.
So, because you learn a better appearance model, right? Otherwise, you have to, how do you learn from the full image features or camera model? It's better to reason in the space of localized cameras, right? So now you'll have a neuron which is centered on the camera, which only looks at the camera pixels, sort of.
Then you should be using this for even training ImageNet networks.
Yes, but ImageNet has centered objects, so that's not too much of a big deal. I mean, we are not the first one to use multiple instance learning for better classification. I mean, there have been numerous papers which do it. In fact, on Pascal, I'm sure the leading method is actually one of these methods from Leo Button's group and so on. This is for classification.
So the problem is that if you're evaluating for detection, then it will make sense. But if you're evaluating for classification.
No, I think it will make sense for classification because you have images which have composition of objects. You not only
Whatever the task you're testing on, if you train on that.
Yeah, but that is exactly, the loss is actually on the full image. You're not penalizing it for localizing it incorrectly.
Right.
So it is end-to-end in that manner. I mean, this is the apples-to-apple experiment, the classification versus multiple instance learning. Right. In fact, this does not work for detection because it starts to latch on these scene context features and which screw you up for detection.
Okay, I can take it offline.
Right. So what, I mean, as I was saying, you get basically lots of these attribute classifiers which can, you can, like, for example, this is a holding detector. I mean, how the hell will you annotate anything for holding? But you, basically, this pops out, and which is, you know, interesting to look at. Swinging, I mean, it's kind of hard for someone to actually go out and annotate, okay, what does swinging mean? But this just emerges out of the data. So now, once you have these concepts that you have detected, now you take a language model. What is a language model? It basically is something that will, the probability of next word, of the next word depends on, I mean, given the previous words, you can compute a probability on what the next word should be, and that's what a probability model does, a language model does for you. And the key difference over here is now you want to condition it on a set of words that you have detected. You want to say, okay, I want to express these words in the sentence that you have. So for example, if you've already said a man holding a camera in so you'll pick one, or try to pick, bias your language model to more frequently spit out words from the blackboard. And once you spit out a word, you just scratch it out. And then this is the global re-ranking step, which is fairly similar. You have like a pair of networks. You feed in the sentence over here, you feed in the image, and you want to say, okay, the representation at the end should be similar for similar caption image pairs and not similar for, and dissimilar for not caption and image pairs. And what this resulted in, there was a captioning contest last year at CVPR, and there were lots of teams from Google, Stanford, and so forth. And we were basically tied at the top place with Google. So this was good. This was also, Microsoft recently released an app called Seeing AI, which helps blind people understand the visual world around them. And some part of the system is also in use in the Seeing AI app. So this is what it is. Right, and what you also get out of this is some amount of interpretability. So because of this weekly supervised way of doing this, you also have some notion of where the different words that you spit out correspond to, what is the visual signal in the image that you use to determine them. So for example, you know where the man is, where the sitting is happening, where the couch is, and where the dog is. So you get some amount of interpretability. Yeah, go on. So the re-ranker is basically, on the language side, it is not just a bag of words. It also has, it is basically a convolutional network. So you take letter trigrams and you make the sentence into a letter trigram, and then you do convolutions on them. So that captures some of the grammatical.
When you look at the results, do they look
I think they are fairly, they are grammatical. If you do a paired test between humans and the machine generated, the humans will rank higher on the grammatical, on the grammar, but it's not that bad. I mean, the score would be high enough already. Yeah, I mean, the other thing is this language model was trained on human data, right? So, I mean, if the language model actually trained properly, then it will respect basic, some basic grammar, not all basic grammar. I know it has this history issue, but yeah, it's a good point. Right. Okay, so basically building on from the interpretability point of view, what we started looking at when I came back to Berkeley was this task of visual semantic role labeling. So we want to, like caption generation, language has some good things which it brings in that you have this abstraction, that you have this high level semantics that come in, but then it was incredibly hard to evaluate any such thing. So what we came up with, I mean, motivated from this fine-grained reasoning and so forth, like more detailed understanding of images, we were motivated to say, okay, can we do a similar fine, detailed understanding from just images which can be evaluated in a better manner? So what we came up with this was this task of visual semantic role labeling. So here, basically, we focused on people doing actions and then what objects they are interacting with. So whenever there's an action, there are different roles, semantic roles that are there associated with that action. So for example, if you have an action called hitting, so there's an actor who is doing the action, which is this person. There's an object that is being hit, which is this ball in the orange box. And then there's this instrument which is actually being used to hit the ball. And these form different semantic roles for that particular action. And what we wanted to do, some of the language that, what the visualizations that I showed you before, there was some sort of localization that was happening, which was good in this sense that, okay, you know that this man is sitting on this couch. We wanted to basically make that more concrete and say, okay, can we actually come up with a task where we can evaluate such things in a grounded manner? And that's where we basically collected this data set so we came up with this task where you want to say, okay, here is this person, it is doing this action, and these are the different objects that are in different semantic roles. Here is the bat that is being used to hit, and here is the ball that is being hit. So each action has this, these semantic roles, and we want to localize them. And so this is basically this task of visual semantic role labeling. To study this task, we basically annotated action labels and these semantic roles on the COCO dataset. So you already have these objects that have been grounded in the image, like you have bounding boxes and segmentations. And what we did was, okay, for each person that is there in this image, so we did this with some 10,000 images on COCO, for each person that is annotated, you basically say, okay, what actions it is doing. And we focused on these atomic actions, like simple actions like carry, catch, cut, drink. I mean, these are very simple actions that you can infer from a single image. And I mean, these are fairly generic. So a lot of these actions will apply to a lot of different people, as opposed to like playing cricket or playing badminton, I mean, and the like. And then for each of these actions, you also have, okay, what is the object of interaction? What are the different objects in different semantic roles? So if you have work on computer, where is the computer that you're working on? If you have this action called throw, you know that, okay, what is the object that is being thrown? So basically, this is like grounded visual semantic role labeling. That's what we are trying to call it. Here is an example image. So each person can be doing multiple actions. So in this particular image, this woman is cutting something using the knife, and this is the bread that is being cut. She's smiling. She is eating with the knife the bread. I mean, so you can... each person can be doing multiple different actions, and we annotated this densely on all people in the 10,000 images. This lady is looking at this bread, she's sitting on this chair, she's holding the knife and the bread. So you have this detailed understanding of what the action is. So what this allows us to do is to study action recognition in a detection setting. So if you look at action literature, it's mostly about action classification or maybe somewhat about detection, but then this goes a step forward and says, okay, you want to detect people, and then you also want to detect their different actions, different semantic roles of the action. And it allows us to learn how people used various objects for different actions. So if you have a system which can now detect people doing different actions and what objects they're interacting, it also tells you what you can do with a particular object, which I will later connect to how it works with the earlier work that I've done. So we also have some baseline models where you try to solve this task. So you have CNN features that you compute on the box, you compute CNN features on the object that you have, and you compute like a distance vector between the two to capture the relationship between them, and you feed them in a neural network, and you try to train this model. And I mean, yes, so I mean, this actually leads to improvement in the visual semantic role labeling average precision from 29.3 to 33.6. And here is some output. So you have this person. It is skateboarding, and this is the skateboard. This person is eating, and this is the thing that is getting eaten. This is a lady is hitting the ball with the racket. This is this person who is riding the horse. So you know which horse is being ridden. So, yeah, as I mentioned, this basically also, I mean, this is now bleeding into future work, and I mean, we have not necessarily done these things, but this is where I think this should go, is basically it also allows you to understand what you can do with an object. So you can use a scissor to cut a tie. So if you can reliably detect these concepts in images, then you can come up with these things. So you can use a racket to hit a ball. You can use a knife to cut bread. So it can allow you to mine all this common sense that exists in images. And right, as I said, this is going to bleed into future work. So what I told you about so far was detailed 3D scene understanding. There has been lots of work that has gone into object manipulation. So for example, you have work from Pinto et al. And Levine et al. On how to actually precisely grasp objects and so forth. Now, but then if you want your robot to make coffee for you, there are all these other questions that you don't have an answer to yet. So how does it know it has to go to the kitchen? How does it know that it should open the fridge to find the milk? How does it know it needs to use the coffee machine? How does it know that coffee is served in a coffee mug and not a beer mug? And so forth. So there are all these high-level semantic questions that neither, that are still not very well addressed, I believe, in literature. And right, so basically what I'm trying to go for is this visual common sense for robots. So how can you basically mine all of this information such that now once you have a 3D understanding of the scene, you know how to grasp objects, you can actually try to make coffee, get your robot to make coffee for you. So I think that's where I'm personally headed. And how can we acquire this functional understanding of objects? Can this be done by observing people using objects? And can language, does language have a role to play in this particular thing? Thank you. I'll take questions.